Hi viewers, in this video I will show you how I checked the brake vacuum system on my 2007 Volvo S40 to find out why the vacuum pump was taking too long before turning off.
In the last weeks, I noticed that the brake booster vacuum pump was running longer than usual when I started the engine. Finally, one day when I turned off the engine, the vacuum pump kept running. The pump was so hot that when I was disconnecting it, I burned one of my fingers when I barely touched it. But usually, when a vacuum pump is running far too long, it means that there's a vacuum leak caused by a defective fitting or by a leaking one-way check valve in one of the hose assemblies. Nevertheless, the vacuum pump, the vacuum switch, and the brake booster can also cause this problem. The next day, I went to a Upol Auto Recycling facility and I bought three parts: a hose and check valve assembly, a hose and vacuum switch assembly, and a brake vacuum pump. To test the extra brake vacuum pump, I used a push bottom switch, a hand vacuum pump, and a car battery. Then I installed a hose adapter between the hand vacuum pump and the brake vacuum pump. Normally, this type of pump should produce a vacuum between minus 80 and minus 90 kilopascals. At minus 90 kilopascals, this pump was fine. Since I wanted to replace the vacuum pump that was installed, I removed it, but I also compared the vacuum level on the workbench. I was curious to know the vacuum level, so I tested my old pump. The result was also near minus 90 kilopascals. Because this pump had overheated, I only kept it as a spare part in case of emergency. The next part I tested was the hose and vacuum switch assembly I just bought. When there is no vacuum applied to the vacuum switch, it is normally turned on. Then the current can flow between those two wires to energize the brake vacuum pump. I checked the resistance between the two wires and it was zero, so there was a switch contact. Another way to test it is to use a car battery and a 12-volt bulb as shown. To simulate a vacuum condition that should turn off the vacuum switch, I used a handheld vacuum pump, a vacuum hose adapter, and a push-in rubber plug. First, I inserted the rubber plug in the opening beside the one-way check valve and the vacuum switch assembly. Next, I fitted the hose adapter between the handheld vacuum pump and the hose assembly. After that, I reconnected the wire to turn the light on and test the vacuum switch. A brand new vacuum switch should turn off and cut the current when the vacuum reaches minus 60 kilopascals. I did different tests, and this extra switch was turning off when the vacuum levels were reaching around minus 54 kilopascals. It was acceptable for my needs, but I still had to compare it against the hose and vacuum switch assembly that was installed on my vehicle. Next, to perform a similar test, I unplugged and removed the hose and check valve assembly. I also removed the battery and the battery tray to gain access to the hose and vacuum switch assembly. Here, you can see where the hose assembly is plugged into the brake booster. This is the vacuum switch electrical plug. I disconnected it and I connected my homemade electrical harness built with a light bulb. This harness was directly powered by the car battery. The other end of the vacuum hose was plugged to the handheld vacuum pump via a custom hose adapter. The brake booster had more air volume than my pump, so I had to pump a lot to generate an adequate vacuum to turn off the vacuum switch. I tried this procedure three times, and the average vacuum level required to turn off the switch was around minus 56 kilopascals. After, I unplugged the vacuum pump to know how long the one-way check valve would maintain the vacuum level to keep the vacuum switch in the off position. I waited 2 hours, and when I came back to the garage, the switch was still in the off position. This result indicated that the brake booster, the one-way check valve, and the vacuum switch were probably in good condition. Therefore, I did not replace the hose and vacuum switch assembly. Next, I reconnected the vacuum switch plug. I also installed the extra vacuum pump, the battery tray, and the battery. Later, when I installed the hose and check valve assembly, I noticed something. The hose connected into the quick connect receptacle of the upper intake manifold was not fitting properly. It looked like the thermoformed plastic hose had lost its original bending angle over the years. I removed the vacuum hose assembly and I compared it with two other ones. I used an angle finder to measure the difference between some vent sections of the hoses. To solve the problem quickly, I used my heat gun to modify the bending angle of this section. At first, it was a 97 degree angle. Then I changed it to a 93 degree angle. When I reinstalled the hose assembly, the end of the hose branch was better aligned with the quick connect fitting. This is a test to show that only a very small hole in the vacuum line can prevent the vacuum switch from turning on when the required vacuum level is not reached. Not long after, the work was completed.
These 17 years old vacuum parts are getting out of specs, but at least, after several weeks, they are functioning normally.